All right, take a look with me. Romans chapter 12. We're going to begin reading in verse 1, thinking about love. Romans 12, verse 1. Paul says, "Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, and then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will." Look at verse 3. "For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given to us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully." Look at Romans 12, verse 9. Incredibly important verse. "Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need and practice hospitality." We'll stop there. Let's pray. Let's invite the Holy Spirit to minister to us. Lord, thank you for this morning. Thank you for the people you love so much. Thank you for your presence with us. Lord, I pray that you'd open our spiritual eyes and ears. Lord, give us humble hearts to receive your word. Quicken our minds. Enable us to receive the eternal truth of God. Lord, I pray we'd encounter you as we share your word. Would your heart, if your heart agrees, would you say amen and amen? For the last few weeks, we've been talking about the transformed Christian mind. In Romans 12, 2, Paul says, if we want to discover and do God's will, a mental metamorphosis is required. Do not be conformed. Don't be pushed into the mold of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, and then you'll be able to test and approve God's will. If we're going to discover and do God's will, we must think differently than we did before we knew Jesus. We have to adopt a different mindset. We have to pursue different priorities. We have to embrace different values. We shared with you that that word transformed is the word metamorphosis. It describes the transformation of a tadpole into a bullfrog or a caterpillar into a butterfly. And what that tells us is that the change that we need in our thinking is a radical change. Our thinking doesn't need just a little tweaking. It needs a major overhaul. When you see a beautiful, colorful butterfly take flight, you can't believe that it came from that creepy, crawly thing that was on the stick. It's unrecognizable now, and that's the kind of radical change that we need in our thinking so that our new mindset is unrecognizable from what it once was. It also means that the change we need is a gradual process. In fact, Paul tells us with these words that it's a continual process. In Romans 12, 2, Paul says we have to be transformed in our mind so that we can do God's will. And then in verse 3, he begins to describe how the transformed mind thinks. And he starts with the subject of love. Love must be sincere. Isn't it interesting that out of all the topics that Paul could choose to describe the transformed mind, he begins with love? Maybe it's because love is the very essence of God's being. Love is not just what God does. Love is who he is. Or maybe it's because love is so fundamental to us as human beings. Our concept of love and our capacity to love and be loved determines the quality of our whole life. Paul is saying in Romans 12, you need a radical change in the way you think, beginning with how you think about love. Don't follow the world's pattern of thinking about love. Be transformed and think in a new way about love. Can I tell you that the world has a broken notion of love? It has a corrupted concept of love that can be traced all the way back to the serpent's big lie in the garden. In Genesis, the Bible says that God placed Adam and Eve in the garden, and he provided them with an abundance of trees of every kind of variety, and they were all beautiful to look at, and they all had good fruit. But in the middle of the garden, God planted one tree, and he told them, you can eat from every other tree, but not that one. Along came the serpent, and he sowed corrupt seeds in their thinking about love. If God really loved you, he would have never given you any prohibitions. If God really loved you, he would have never put any boundaries on you. If God really loved you, he wouldn't have made you incomplete and then denied you the very thing that would make you complete. Do you know that was implicit in the enemy's big lie? When God caught up to Adam and Eve after they sinned, the first question God asked them was, who told you that you were naked? Who told you that there was something wrong with you? Who told you that you were incomplete the way that I made you? Who told you that you needed something more than what I had provided for you? That's good preaching right there. If God really loved you, he'd let you make your own decisions. He'd let you decide for yourself what's best for you. If God really loved you, he would never withhold from you something you're drawn to. If God really loves you, he will never punish you. Adam and Eve disobeyed God and they were cut off from his love. Listen, it's important you understand God never stopped loving them, but they lost the ability to receive his love and to reciprocate his love, and their ability to love one another was also seriously damaged. Shame and fear and blame and evading responsibility and lying and withdrawing entered into their relationship with one another. They began to spat, and married couples have been spatting ever since. You know, we could look at Romans 12:9 from the other side, and we could say this: if the love of a transformed heart and mind is sincere love, then perhaps we could call the love of an unregenerate heart and mind insincere. It's insincere because it's inherently self-centered. Its focus is self-fulfillment and self-satisfaction and self-gratification rather than serving others. So what might this insincere love look like? Give a listen and see if anything sounds at all familiar to you. Insincere love provides affirmation without accountability. Insincere love offers comfort without caution or constructive criticism or correction. Insincere love flaunts free choice without consequences. Insincere love encourages self-expression without submission to God or to others. Autonomy without boundaries, individuality without responsibility, intimacy without covenant loyalty, following one's feelings without fidelity. Do you know, one of the great ironies of our day is that if someone is inclined to be unfaithful to his or her spouse, there are secular counselors out there who encourage them to act on that, and they call it taking responsibility for their feelings. I know, because I have worked with more than one couple over the years who that was the counsel that they received. As if our feelings are to be honored above our vows and our commitments. Own your lust rather than turning away from it. Isn't that precisely what Eve was prodded to do by the serpent? Insincere love says, go ahead, have a great big bite of that forbidden fruit. You needn't worry about any negative repercussions on yourself or on your relationships. You shall not surely die, for in the day that you eat it, God knows your eyes will be opened and you shall be like God. In other words, nothing bad will happen to you. You'll be in control. Beloved, does any of that sound familiar to you at all? It should, because the world has pushed a narrative on us that to disagree with someone is to hate him or her. To state one's belief is to somehow injure someone who perhaps believes differently. To refuse to tacitly affirm someone's beliefs or choices is to somehow to dehumanize him and her. If you don't let me do whatever I want without saying anything, you don't love me. Not only does that sound like a two-year-old, it sounds like the serpent in the garden. And it's simply not true. I can love you and yet disagree with you. I love my family with all my heart, but I don't like all their choices. I can hold a set of beliefs and I can speak about them without hating or disrespecting or dehumanizing those who believe differently. Paul says that living in this world, we need a radical mental metamorphosis. And the first place that our thinking needs to be transformed is our concept of love. So how should we think about love? Looking at Paul's words in Romans 12, I see five thoughts that I want to share with you quickly. Excuse me. How should we think about love? Five thoughts from Romans 12. First of all, sincere love is humble. Sincere love is humble. Paul says, don't be conformed to the pattern of this world. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Do not think of yourself more highly than you ought to. Rather, think of yourself with sober judgment according to the faith God has given you. The first way that a transformed Christian mind thinks differently is the way we think about ourselves. The essence of Satan's rebellion against God was pride. Although he was a created being, he wanted to be at the center of everything and the center of attention. And in the garden, he incited that same pride in the heart of mankind. He enticed Adam and Eve to put themselves in the center. He prodded them to satisfy their own wants and needs and curiosities rather than serve God and one another. And fallen men have put themselves in the center ever since. Someone once said, humility is not thinking less of yourself, it's thinking of yourself less. And you know, that's pretty accurate. In 1 Corinthians 13, the love chapter, Paul says, sincere love is not proud. It's not puffed up. It doesn't seek its own. If we want to sincerely love others, then we have to overcome pride. The transformed Christian mind overcomes pride by constantly recalling that we have been the recipients of great grace and mercy. In Romans 12:1, Paul says, by the mercies of God, you've been saved, so offer your whole self back to him. In Romans 12:3, Paul says, I am what I am because of the grace of God, and you are too. Think about that. In Romans 12:4, he says, think about it. Even your faith isn't yours. You have it because God measured it out to you. The transformed Christian mind subdues pride by recalling that everything I am and everything that I have is only because of grace, so there's no occasion for boasting. To the Ephesians, Paul wrote, for by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God. What is the gift of God? Both the saving grace and the saving faith that secured it. This is not by works, Paul says, so that no one can boast. To the Corinthians, he wrote, for what do you have that you did not receive from God? And if you received it as a gift, why do you boast about it as if you didn't? You see, the breath in your lungs this morning is a gift from God. Your ability to think and to emote and to express yourself and to make choices is a gift from God. Your family and everything you have is a gift from God. Even the very faith in your heart this morning is a gift from God. So be humble. The transformed Christian mind subdues pride through continual gratitude to God and constant reliance on grace. I'm grateful for grace. I'm indebted to grace. I'm obligated to grace. I'm reliant on grace. How should we think about love? Five thoughts from Romans 12. Number one, sincere love is humble. Number two, sincere love is interdependent. From humility flows interdependence. Don't be conformed to the pattern of this world. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Don't think more highly of yourself than you ought to think. Just as each of us has one body with many members, and each member has a different function, so in Christ, we who are many form one body. Insincere love is self-centered, and it is fiercely independent. It says, follow your own heart, no matter what the cost to your family or your friends or your community. The problem with that is the Bible says your own heart is deceitful. The Bible says your own heart is full of hidden motives that you yourself don't even understand. You can't trust your own heart. Sincere love is neither independent nor codependent. Sincere love is interdependent. It is responsible to others, and it is responsible for others. Sincere love recognizes that we need God first, and we need each other second. Listen, this is what Paul is saying in these verses. I like this. This is the heart of what he's saying. What Paul is saying is, God has given me everything I have, but God hasn't given me everything he has. Everything I have is from God, but God hasn't given to any one of us everything he has. Instead, God has distributed it widely across the entire body of Christ, and that's why we need each other. That's good right there. But Paul uses his favorite metaphor for the church here, a body. But we have to understand that Paul is not just giving us little warm, fuzzy pictures. He's telling us important spiritual realities in Christ. We are vitally and organically connected to one another in a way that exceeds my ability to really explain to you. The Holy Spirit has gathered us together in Jesus into a new living organism, the body of Christ. We fundamentally belong together, and we critically need one another. Just like all the members of our human body have different functions, so each member in the body of Christ has different functions. Each one of us has gifts, each one of us has different gifts, and each one of our gifts is needed by the whole. God has given me everything I have, but he hasn't given me everything he has. He gave some of it to you, and that's why I need you. It's good right there. You see, I can't achieve the transformed Christian mind without you. I can't discover and do the will of the Father without you. I can't learn to love sincerely without you. I can't win the race of this Christian life without you. There was a great preacher named Stuart Briscoe who tells about how in 1970 he attended the final game of the World Cup where Brazil beat Italy. The legendary player Pelé passed the ball to the team captain Carlos Alberto. Stuart Briscoe said he saw Alberto make a play that was so epic it was etched in his mind forever. He said Alberto, standing in front of the goal, jumped high up into the air. He caught the ball. He received it with his chest. He rolled it down his body onto his left foot. He flipped it from his left foot to his right foot, and then he drove it into the corner of the goal, and the Italian goalie never had a chance. That's actually the moment right there. And Stuart Briscoe thought to himself, how many members of his body did he just use to make that goal? And the answer was all of them. And not only that, but it took 8 passes by 7 different players. Pelé passed it twice in that play. It took 8 passes by 7 players to get the ball to him to make the goal. So his whole body was working, and his whole team was working together, and that's what it took to win. Beloved, can I tell you something? We're in the final match of the World Cup with phase two right here. And the reason we're winning is because of the whole body. The reason we're winning is because of the prayers of the whole body. I don't know what you have contributed to the building yourself, but if you want to know what the intercessors have contributed, it's over $12 million because from their prayers, the cost of the building has been cut from over $24 million to $12 million. Come on. We're winning because of the engagement of the whole body. We're winning because of the faithfulness of the whole body. We're winning because of the endurance of the whole body. We're winning because of the sacrificial giving of the whole body. We are interdependent. God hasn't given any one of us all that we need, and that's why we need each other. How should we think about love? Love is humble. Love is interdependent. Number three, sincere love is joyfully generous. Listen to this. Because we are interdependent, it is incumbent on us to make the very most of ourselves for the sake of others that we love. God has given me everything I have, but He hasn't given me everything He has. He gave some of it to you. I have some of what you need, and you have some of what I need. Therefore, love requires that I make the very most of my gifts so that I can make God's very best available to you, and love requires the same of you. It's my duty of love to make the very most of my spiritual gifts for your sake, and it's your duty to do the same for me. This is good right here. Paul expresses, follow with me, stay with me. Paul expresses this thought in Romans 11:3. When he talks about our role in making the Jewish people jealous in a godly way, his role as an apostle, his call to make his own Jewish people jealous for Jesus. This is what he says in Romans 11:13. He says, I make the most of my ministry so that I can arouse as many of my own Jewish people to envy and so to save them. Paul is saying, I pray, I fast, I study the word, I keep myself pure, I give, I forgive, so that I'm ready to be used by God to bless you. I stay in tune with the Holy Spirit. I avoid the things that would dull my spiritual senses. I stay sharp and alert in the Spirit so that I'm ready at a moment's notice to be used by God with my gifts to bless you. Beloved, can I tell you something? It is time that Christians start operating in the gift of discernment once again. Amen. You know, there might be some things that are permissible for us. We argue, can I, as a believer, can I do this? Can I do that? Can I see this movie? Can I see that movie? Can I go here? Can I go there? There might be some things. Paul says there are some things that might be permissible, but they might not be productive for you. They might dull your spiritual senses so that you're not sharp and you're not alert and you're not ready. You know, the key to Jesus' success in ministry, Jesus said, I only do what I see my Father doing and say what I hear my Father saying. Jesus fasted and he prayed and he kept himself pure and he avoided the things that would dull his spiritual senses so that he was ready at any given moment to be used by God to bless others. And that's what love calls us to do as well. Paul lists seven spiritual gifts here as examples. This is not an exhaustive list. There are as many as 19 spiritual gifts listed in the New Testament. But Paul's point here is whatever gift God has given you, develop it so that you can generously distribute it. If your gift is prophecy, then build up your faith so that you can prophesy with accuracy and with anointing. If your gift is serving, serve with all your might. If your gift is teaching the word, become the best teacher that you can. If your gift is encouraging, which I really believe is the ministry of Christian counseling and mentoring, then become the best encourager that you can. If your gift is giving to the needs of others, become the most generous giver you can. If your gift is leading, lead diligently. If it's showing mercy, prepare your heart so that if people don't appreciate your sacrifices and acts of service, you can keep a cheerful spirit anyway. Peter and John met a lame man outside the temple one day. And the man asked them for a coin, but Peter and John had no money. That's how you know they were Pentecostals, no money. They had no money. That's how you know. They said, "We don't have any money, but what we do have, we'll gladly give to you." Peter and John did not have any silver or any gold, but they did have the spiritual gift of healing. They did have the gift of faith. They did have the gift of working of miracles. And because they prayed every day and built themselves up in the word every day and walked in unity and humility and integrity every day, they were able to distribute that gift that day. Amen. And that's exactly what sincere love does. It makes the most of oneself spiritually for the sake of others. Husbands and dads, listen to me. You make the most of yourself spiritually for the sake of your wives and your children. Make the most of your physical health. Make the most of yourself intellectually. Make the most of yourself professionally. Make the most of your finances for their sake. Insincere love says indulge yourself. Sincere love says improve yourself for their sakes. Wives and mothers, make the most of yourselves spiritually for the sake of your husbands and children. Make the most of your physical health for his sake. Make the most of your gifts and talents. Make the most of your home. Make the most of your finance. Friends, make the most of yourself for the sake of your friends. Children, make the most of yourself so that you can bless your parents back when they're old and worn out. I'm going to preach that next service when my kids are sitting here on the front row. Make the most of yourself. So when your parents are old and worn out, they change your diapers when you were young. Make something of yourself so you can bless them when they get older. There's a word I like here in Romans 12, 13. Paul says, practice hospitality. You know, I like that word, practice. What that means is God doesn't expect me to get it perfect right away, but he does want me to keep on working on it. He does want me to keep on growing. He does want me to keep on developing. He wants me to keep on pressing onward. The metamorphosis from self-centered love to generous love is a process. But if we keep on practicing, we're going to get there. I want to get there. I want to make that journey. I want to get there and reach that love that's generous. How should we think about love? Five thoughts from Romans 12. Sincere love is humble. Sincere love is interdependent. Sincere love is joyfully generous. Number four, sincere love, I like this, is my favorite one. Sincere love is brotherly devotion. Beloved, listen to me. There has never been a time where we've needed the words of Romans 12, 9 more than we need them today. You know, the most well-known verse in the Bible used to be John 3, 16. Now it's Matthew 7, 1, quoted, of course, completely out of context. Do not judge, lest ye be judged. How I wish that everyone who knew Matthew 7, 1 knew Romans 12, 9 instead. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. You see, sick love promotes affirmation without accountability. Sick love promotes self-expression with no boundaries, free choice with no consequences. Healthy love has moral boundaries. Healthy love recognizes that there are absolute rights and wrongs. Beloved, listen to me. All the world is not 50 shades of gray. Don't call gray what God has said in his word is black and white. Healthy love has terms. Healthy love has covenant loyalty. Healthy love is accountable to God, and it's accountable to others, and it holds others accountable. Healthy love has both a negative and a positive side. Healthy love hates what God calls evil because it's bad for people. It destroys them and it leads to eternal death. Healthy love clings tenaciously to what God has called good because it blesses people and it leads to eternal life.
Listen to me. Healthy love is fiery, passionate. It is ardent. It is not passive. It is not laissez-faire. If I see you going down, I'm going to do everything in my power to rescue you.
When our twins were just toddlers, we went to visit my mom in the suburbs of Philly one day. My mom had a built-in pool, and the kids were swimming with those, you know, inflatable water wings. And we took a little break for lunch, and we took the water wings off the kids, and I went into the house for a minute, and everyone was just sitting around relaxing, and Ben decided to go back into the pool, not realizing what would happen without his water wings on. And he jumped right into the deep end and sank straight to the bottom. Now, my wife Denise has never been a very strong swimmer. She doesn't much care for the water, let alone the deep end. But when she saw her son go down to the bottom, she turned into Michael Flipping Phelps. She dove into the pool, hair, makeup, jewelry, clothes and all, and she brought my son up, and I think she gave that pool a good beating just for messing with him. And that's precisely what Paul means when he says, love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. If I see you going down the wrong path, if I see you going down the road to destruction, I'm not going to stand by the side of the pool and say, meh, it's your choice. No, I'm going in and I'm going to bring you up by God. Cain irreverently and sarcastically asked God, am I my brother's keeper? And God said to him, yes, you are. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. And be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Beloved, can I tell you, the world has a broken concept of love. They have a corrupt concept. Paul says that our thinking about love needs a radical change. You know, the starting place for really understanding love is the cross of Jesus Christ. John said, this is how we know what love is. Jesus laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. This is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us, and he gave Jesus as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Paul said, God demonstrated his love for us in this, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Jesus said, no greater love has any man than this, but that he lay down his life for my friends. You are my friends. Here's what the cross teaches us about the love of God. The cross says, first of all, I'm not going to let you get away with that. The cross says, I'm not going to leave your sin problem unaddressed. I'm not going to let you carry on the way you are. I am going to hold you accountable. But at the same time, the cross says, I am never going to let you go. I'm going to hold you accountable, but I am bringing you up with me. I'm going to hold you accountable, but I am never letting go of your hand. I am going to hold you accountable, but I am never going to leave you. I am never going to forsake you. I am going to lay down my life to make sure that you make it. What other Savior is there like Jesus? What other God rescues like he rescues? What other God confronts our sin and then lifts us up out of it like he does? What other God loves us so purely and so completely and so productively like he does? How should we think about love? Five thoughts. Love is humble, interdependent, joyfully generous. Love is brotherly devotion. Finally, this sincere love is fiery devotion to God. Worship team, you can come help me. Sincere love is fiery devotion to God. We didn't read on in chapter 12. We didn't read verse 14 and onward. But if we did, Paul goes on to, he talks first about how we love within the body of Christ. And then he talks about how we love non-Christians and anti-Christians. And then he goes on in the next chapter to talk about how we love those in government. Boy, do we need that sermon right now. Can I tell you, like, it keeps getting harder, right? Like this is the hothouse. This is the laboratory. We learn to love one another in here first before we love those out there. If we can't do it in here, if we can't figure out how to love one another with brotherly devotion in here, then how on earth will we ever love them out there? I mean, at least we mostly agree, right, in here. But before Paul moves on to how we love non-Christians and anti-Christians, he tells us one more thing about sincere love. And what he tells us is that the most loving thing that we can ever do for others is to love God with our whole heart and sincerely fan the flame of that love. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor ablaze, is what it says in Greek, serving the Lord. Joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer. When Adam and Eve sinned, they were cut off from God's love. He never stopped loving them, but they were unable to receive his love and reciprocate his love, and it damaged their ability to love one another. Through faith in the cross, our love connection with God has been restored. And the more we grow in love with him, the more we're able to love others too. Paul says, don't be lazy in zeal. Keep your spiritual life blazing. Stay red hot on fire for Jesus. When Denise and I got married, the one thing that she always wanted was a fireplace. She grew up with one in Canada. And we moved 5 times in the first 14 years of our marriage. And we finally got our fireplace when we moved to the parsonage just down the street. And we use our fireplace all winter long. Every night that we're home, pretty much we light a fire. My son Ben has become quite a good fire builder. And the girls like to stand and just lean their backs against the fireplace screen, and they like to warm up. And my daughter Maddie was doing that the other night. And she said to me, she said, Dad, your fires are a lot hotter than Ben's fires. And there's a reason for that. I feed my fires more. You see, whenever Denise asks, Ben's a good boy, he comes down from upstairs and he builds a fire for her. And then he goes back up to do his homework or whatever it is that he does up there. And someone might notice that the fire is burning down and throw a log on here or there. But when I build a fire, I sit next to it in a chair and study, and I feed it the entire time. And the result is that everything heats up much more. The firebox, the hearth, we have a Connecticut fieldstone mantle, and the whole thing heats up. In fact, we have candles on our mantle, and we melt the candles because of the heat coming out of the fireplace. And that's just like our spiritual life. If you are in Christ, God has put a fire in your firebox, but how much do you feed your fire? Paul says, if you really want to sincerely love others, then feed the fire. Feed the fire by serving. Do you know that when you serve others, love grows in your heart for them? When you serve them in the body of Christ, volunteering in the community is good. You should volunteer. Volunteer all you can. But I want to tell you, when you serve in the body of Christ, it's supernatural. And it yields a supernatural result of the love of God growing in your heart for people. Could someone else serve in the parking lot? I'm sure someone could. Could someone else be an usher or a greeter? Of course. Could someone else teach Sunday school, sing on the worship team? Well, not just anybody can sing on the worship team. Could somebody else serve on the board or the building committee? Of course, there's someone else who can serve. But why should you serve? Because it feeds the fire. Feed the fire of hope inside of you by feeding on the Word of God. What's phase two for the God who split the Red Sea in two and then closed it again and drowned Pharaoh's horses and chariots? Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we remember the name of the Lord our God. What's our financial need for the God who commands provision over his people, whether by ravens or widows
or angels? What sickness for the God who said, I am the Lord who healeth thee? And we know this, that all things work together for good for those that love God and are called according to his purpose. What shall we say to these things? What shall we say to these mountains in front of us? If God be for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but offered him up freely for us, how will he not also together with Jesus give us all things? You see, that was just 20 seconds of the word, and I just fed somebody's fire right now. I just fed your fire a little bit. I feel like Jim Morrison in The Doors. I just lit your fire right there. I just gave you a little fuel for the fire. Feed the fire. Feed the fire with worship while you're going through suffering, while you're going through hard times, while you're under pressure. Remind yourself through worship of who God is and what he's done and what he's promised, and feed the fire with prayer while you're waiting for God to break through with an answer. Jesus said, pray and never give up. Ask and it shall be given to you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and the door shall be opened unto you. Feed the fire of Christ's life inside of you. Feed the fire of your devotion. Feed the fire of your faith. Feed the fire of your love for God. And then you'll be able to sincerely love others too. How should we think about love? Five thoughts. Love is humble, interdependent, generous. Love is brotherly devotion, and sincere love is fiery devotion to God. Would you stand and give the Lord a praise in this place this morning?